Happy day, I'll never be the same. Isn't it wonderful to be in the house of the Lord this morning? praising Him. Beautiful weather outside. Wonderful oxygen that we're breathing. We're not in the hospital. We're not somewhere else. We're in the house of the Lord. That's a gift from God this morning. That's a gift from our Heavenly Father. Welcome to church. I hope you have a great time here today in the presence of the Lord. Let's pray. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the gift of life. Father, thank you that it's in the little things that we enjoy life. Oh God, thank you for love. Thank you for flowers. Thank you for good food. Thank you for safety. Things that we take for granted in our nation, God. And God, as we remember tomorrow, those that died while on military duty, Father, we are a grateful nation today. The history of the United States would have been very different had it not been for the men and women that gave it all. Father, we thank you for our veterans. We thank you for those that have served and those that are serving right now. Father, we pray that you will extend your grace and your mercy, and that the angels of God will be right now with everyone of the members of our armed forces all over the world who sacrificed so much. Father, we pray for the families of those who have recently lost a loved one serving in the military, God. Father, let them be comforted in the name of Jesus. Lord, encourage them. Let them know that their sacrifices have not been in vain. Lord, we thank you, God. We thank you, God, for the men and women that have answered the call to serve, to defend the nation, God. We thank you, Father, as we celebrate tomorrow, God, Memorial Day. And we thank you for today, God, as we are already celebrating those lives. Father, thank you, Lord Jesus. You understand, because you gave your all in the prime of your youth. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You gave it all for us, your whole life. And this is why we are here today. And Father, we pray that if anyone is visiting here, Lord, that they will sense your presence, that they will sense the reality of the Holy Spirit speaking to their hearts, God, bringing healing and restoration, God, in the name of Jesus. God, we call forth restoration and families today in the name of Jesus. Reconciliation, God, in Jesus' name. Oh, God, that every family within the sound of my voice will have a harmonious relationship where they will celebrate life together because of Jesus. We give you praise and we give you honor and glory. Clap your hands to the Lord and give him a round of applause to say, thank you, Lord. We love you. We praise you. And then I'd like for you to greet one another before you are seated. Just go to somebody you don't know. Say, I'm glad to see you in the house of the Lord today.
This Sunday, we are so glad that you're here on Memorial Weekend, and I believe that God has great things in store for us today. We thank you for being here. If this is your first time with us, welcome. We hope you feel at home. Enjoy the service, and know we want you to come back and visit again, and then just come every Sunday, because I believe this is a place where we truly are a family of God. Amen. For all of our webcast viewers tuning in from around the world, we're so glad you're with us, and I know God is going to minister to you right where you're at. Well, there are just a few things we want to make you aware of. First of all, we all know that it's Memorial Weekend, and today, following the second service over at the Perry Hall campus, the 20s and 30s are going to be having a cookout. So make sure you come hang out. We're going to have a great time. So just, you know, if you can grab a snack on your way and bring it, that'd be great. But we'll have hamburgers and hot dogs, just a time of fellowship. We're going to enjoy the day together and celebrate this holiday weekend. Brooke will be in the lobby after the service. If you have any questions, need directions, she will help you, all right? Also, we wanted to make you aware, of course, that Monday is Memorial Day. So we want to make sure you have the opportunity to spend it with your family. So Monday night prayer will be canceled, but we'll see you next Monday night at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. And lastly, we have Life Track that is repeated every month, and we will have it this Sunday. Next Sunday is a fifth Sunday month, so we won't have it next Sunday, but we'll start back the first Sunday of the month. If that is a way for you to plug in, to find a little bit more about Life Source, also to find out your gifts and your talents, how to study the Word of God, and how to plug in and serve in God's kingdom. So we want to invite you, Pastor Josh and I, after, it's always every Sunday, after the second service, so around 1:30 in the cafe. All right? God bless you, and have a wonderful Memorial Weekend.
Good morning. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord today. It's good to see you, Tony, in the house of God today, man. Praise the Lord. God's really done a miracle in that man's life. And we thank God for the power of Jesus Christ that is still alive and well. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to worship God in our giving today. In pew rack in front of you, there are giving envelopes. It's an LS with a circle around it. That's for your tithe and offering that belongs here, Earth Ablaze. It's for the offering that goes beyond this house, for our missions work that we do outside of this building around the world. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the privilege of worshiping you and giving today. I pray your richest blessings upon your people as we've gathered together to worship you in spirit and in truth. May the power and the glory of God reside upon each heart, each life, each soul. We give you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Jealousy demanding.
Acts chapter 2, beginning at verse 1, says, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them divided tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Today, may He be the fire inside of you, the fire inside of me, the fire. Come be the flame upon my heart." Would you lift your hands in prayer right now in the spirit of the day of Pentecost and pray, "God, come be the fire inside of me. Come be the flame upon my heart. Come and burn in me, Holy Spirit. Come and burn in me, Holy Spirit. Let the fire burn in me today, Holy Spirit. Burn out everything that needs to be burned out. Let the fire and passion of the Holy Spirit burn, burn, burn. Come be the flame upon my heart. Let my heart be an altar upon which the fire of God is able to reside upon. In the mighty name of Jesus, oh God, let the fire burn on the altar of my heart for you today. Let the fire burn today. In the name of Jesus, give us another Pentecost. Give us another outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Give us another outpouring of the glory of God. Give us another Pentecost in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes.
Here it comes.
God, pour out your spirit right now. In the balcony, on the main floor, in the webcast, God, the viewers watching, let the Holy Spirit just come upon every person, everyone listening, everyone, God, in this building today, come upon us. Holy Spirit, in fire, fire, power, God, come. Hallelujah.
I'm sending my fire to burn up everything that's not like me, so you can be the light. I'm sending my fire to burn up everything that's not like me, so you can be the light. I'm sending my fire to burn up everything that's not like me, so you can be the light. I'm sending my fire to burn up everything that's not like me, so you can be the light. I'm sending my fire to burn up everything that's not like me, so you can be the light. So you can be the light.
Yes, Lord.
So you can be the light.
Oh, yes. Burn in us, Lord, so we can be the light in the darkness, in this world. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come be the fire inside of me, Lord. Come be the flame upon my heart. Burn in me, burn in me. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit is in this place today. Amen. Can't you feel His heat? Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord praise this morning. He's worthy. Glory be to God, yeah. Three things converge on this day. Number one, it's Pentecost Sunday. Amen. The Acts 2 passage that I just shared with you. After the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, Jesus spent 40 days with the disciples, and then the disciples spent 10 days in the upper room. After 50 days, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, the Holy Spirit came. We celebrate that today. Amen. And on the way to church this morning, I was praying, said, Lord, give us another Pentecost. And He's answering prayer this morning. Hallelujah. Aren't you grateful for the Holy Spirit? Today is also Memorial Day weekend, of course. Everybody knows that. It is also, number three, the global day of prayer. Churches worldwide are being called upon to pray. And I first want to address Memorial Day weekend, okay? Father, thank you for your presence here. The power and the fire of the Holy Spirit continue to burn among us mightily. May above all things the name of Jesus be exalted. For it's in His holy name we pray. And let everybody say amen. You may be seated. We are an international church. We have many people from different nations who worship here. We are proud of that, and we celebrate that. As a matter of fact, coming up in October, we'll have World Day, in which we celebrate that fact. But our mother church is also located on American soil. Another fact that we are proud of. Not in an arrogant and boastful way, but we're grateful. Grateful for this land. I know America has a lot of problems. But I want to tell you what, when you've been in some other places in the world, coming back to America is a sweet thing. Isn't that right, Gene? Coming back to America is a good thing. Now listen, the Lord's sending us to many places in the world. And we're grateful that we're able to be used by God in those lands. But we want to remember what God has done in this land. Again, we have our issues. Again, we have our history. But thank God for America. Amen. I'm proud to be American. I realize from a spiritual standpoint, I'm an international pastor. Okay? And I wear that when I go overseas. I don't wear the fact that I'm American. You ought to see my wife when she packs for wherever we're headed. She finds out whatever's going on in that culture, and then she packs accordingly. Tries to blend in. You think she can blend in? Hon, your efforts are to be applauded, but it doesn't happen. Just so I let you know that. This weekend, we remember the lives of the countless men and women who died to give us freedom. They are heroes to whom we owe a debt of gratitude. The top five wartime death tolls are sadly incredible. We have some historians here, Jack, so I expect you to know the answers to these. I'll give you a little test here. The top five wartime death tolls in America's history. These are American lives lost, not cumulative lives from other countries, but American lives lost. What's the first one? Some of you are a little... Civil War. Yeah. Approximately how many lives were lost in the Civil War? Good guess. Approximately 625,000 lives were lost in the Civil War. The second highest wartime death toll would be what? World War II, that's correct. Approximately how many? It's got to be below 625,000 since that's the top one, so that gives you a little guess. 405,000 American lives in World War II. What's the next one? World War I, correct. 116,516 lives. What's next? Vietnam, 58,209. What's number five? Korea, Korean War, 36,516. You total those up, it's 1,241,640 lives. Just in the top five, there are many others, but those who died for the fact that you and I have free speech. So whenever you see somebody on TV who's burning a flag that I personally want to beat up, stomp in the ground. Somebody died to give him that right. We have a lot of freedoms here, but it doesn't come without a price. I want you to stand with me because I want us to pay our respects to the fallen heroes who died, not for a perfect country, but for a free country. And I want you to just spend a moment of silence with me, if you would. Lord, we thank you today that we are able to stand because others have fallen. We thank you for America. We pray for her freedom spiritually. We pray for revival, as we've just sung about, to be poured out on this land. We're believing you for another great awakening, Father. We're believing you for a shaking in this country. We're believing you, God, for a return to the Bible, to prayer, to holy living. Father, hear our prayers and intercessions for this land. And again, thank you so very much. Thank you for each family who has sacrificed. Even recently, Lord, there will be cookouts this weekend. There will be time of celebration. But in some families, there will be somebody missing. Lord, thank you for those families who've sacrificed, and thank you for all the lives of those who gave themselves for this cause. We give you thanks in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Would you just give a round of applause in gratitude? Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Since it is also the global day of prayer, I want you to know that many Christians over the centuries have given their lives for the sake of the gospel. Although lesser known, the death tolls of these Christian martyrs is staggering. The top five death tolls among Christians. Number one, the Russian Orthodox Christians from 1917 to 1950. 15 million martyrs. Number two, Christians in Nazi Germany. 1 million Christians. Christians, number three, in communist China between 1950 and 1980, 700,000. Number four, Ugandan Christians from 1971 to 1979 under the dictatorship of Idi Amin, 300,000. And number five, the Chinese Christians during the Boxer Rebellion, just prior to the 20th century, 200,000. Now, just to give you the contrast, the soldiers who died in wars, the top five, 1,241,640. The Christians who've been martyred, the top five, 17,200,000. This is not by any means to minimize the lives lost in battle. This is simply to give another look at the war that's been on Christians. And that has really been downplayed over the last decades, however, has really come to the surface over the last year. More and more is being said about persecuted Christians. And today, since it's a global day of prayer, I want you to join me in prayer for a few moments as we pray for the nations, as we pray for our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted in various lands, that we lift them up, the body of Christ, that God would move upon us and breathe upon us, and this Pentecost Sunday would pour out His Spirit once again. Amen? So would you join me in prayer? And if your posture in prayer is better sitting, sit. If it's better standing, stand. However you feel most comfortable. But I want you to lift your voice in prayer. Let mine not be the only voice. But on this global day of prayer, let us join our voices with the millions around this planet who will be praying and interceding for the body of Christ. Would you lift your voice in prayer to Almighty God with me today? Father, we come humbly before you today, and we thank you, O God, that we can come to you in prayer. Father, this global day of prayer, we lift up, God, the nations of the earth to you, Father, all over the world. We intercede, God, for the body of Christ who are trying to advance the kingdom of God in some places that are extremely difficult. But we pray that you would send another Pentecost today to the body of Christ around the world. Father, we pray that you would pour out your Spirit in Europe. We ask God the glory of God would flood that continent, that you would move in a mighty way, God, that you would touch those nations. We pray that the power of God would be present, that you would touch the pulpits, you would touch the preachers, you would touch the people of God, and there would be a glorious revival on that continent of reformation, on that continent of God where many have given their lives and shed their blood. We pray, God, that you would move upon them. Touch the Middle East today. God, you see the conflict. You see the tension and turmoil. Father, pour out your Spirit on the Middle East today. We pray for the believers who are trying to hold true but are being persecuted, whose lands are being taken, whose cities are being destroyed, whose families are being murdered and raped and taken away. Father, we ask you today to be with them, undergird them, God. Hear our prayer for the body of Christ in the Middle East. Touch them today, we pray in the name of Jesus. We pray for the body of Christ in Asia. We thank you for what you're doing, God, in the Asian countries. We thank you, God, for the move of your Spirit, Lord, at a grassroots level in many places, God, for the movement of prayer that has taken place over the last several decades in Asia. God, we pray for the believers there that you would continue to strengthen them, continue to anoint them, continue to pour out your Spirit upon them. Lord, we intercede for the body of Christ in Africa. We pray that that continent would be fully ablaze with the glory of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh God, we pray from Morocco and Libya in Egypt all the way to South Africa. Let the power of God explode, God, on that continent. From Sierra Leone in the west, God, to Somalia on the east. Father, let the glory of God capture that continent. Send revival, God, to every nation in Africa for your glory and honor. Lord, we pray, oh God, for the oceanic countries, God. We pray, Lord, for Australia and New Zealand. We pray, God, that you would pour out your Spirit upon the land down under, that, God, they would experience the glory of heaven, the glory of God. We thank you for the sounds of worship that are coming out of there. We thank you, God, for the power of the Holy Spirit that's residing there, God. Let revival break forth in a mighty way. We pray for Latin America, South America, Central America. Let the power of the Holy Spirit, God, capture these nations and countries, and the glory of the Lord fill those nations, we pray. Raise up, God, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers all over the globe for for your glory and honor. And Lord, lastly, we pray for North America. We ask you to touch this land, oh God. We pray for Canada. We pray for the United States. We pray, God, that you would bless this land. We pray, God, that it would be a land, God, in which the glory of God dwells and the body of Christ is strong and the kingdom of God is advancing. Oh Lord, on this global day of prayer, Father, hear our prayer. Hear our supplication to you, Master. Hear us as God as we cry out to heaven, for we must have another move of God. We must have a mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We believe we're in the last days, and we believe the harvest at the end times is going to be the greatest harvest the world has ever seen. So we thank you right now for souls, and we pray the Lord of the harvest that he would send laborers into the harvest field, and that God, there would be a mighty harvest of souls that would come into the kingdom of God for your glory and honor. Lord, we thank you today for hearing and answering prayer. We thank you for what you're going to do in the nations, what you are doing. And we thank you, God, that you're using Life Source International Church to be an instrument of revival in the land in these last days for your glory and honor. In Jesus' holy name we pray. And let everybody say amen. Hallelujah. Give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. God bless you. God bless you. You may be seated. Today is Pentecost Sunday. It is explained in Leviticus 23 as the Feast of Weeks. The first of the later crops were to be offered to the Lord at this time, specifically the wheat harvest. And it is at this time that the Holy Spirit came and set the early church on fire. And I want to share with you this morning reasons you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Let me give you some biblical reasons to start off with. Number one, it's a part of the process in spiritual growth and formation. If you're going to grow in the Lord, if you're going to grow in the things of God, you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Number two, the Holy Spirit was actively involved in the ministry of Jesus. We see that from his baptism. When John baptized him in water and he came up out of the water, the Bible says, and the Spirit of the Lord descended upon him like a dove and rested upon him. And from that point, the Holy Spirit was actively involved in his life and ministry. After he was baptized, the Bible says the Spirit led him into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And on and on and on and on, the Spirit is actively involved. If the Spirit is actively involved in the ministry of Jesus, which is the model for our lives, then we need the Holy Spirit actively involved in us and in our lives. Number three, Jesus taught on the necessity of being filled with the Spirit. In John chapter 7, that last day, the great day of the feast, he said, if anybody's thirsty, let him come after me. And out of his belly, his innermost being, will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, which was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. He talked about the necessity of being filled with the Spirit. Number four, so essential is the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives, Jesus called him the promise of the Father. That's how essential he is. He is the promise of the Father. I'm grateful for that because I don't believe that my Father lies. I don't believe it's possible for my Father to tell me an untruth. If it's a promise, then it's good as done. It is a sure thing. And the Holy Spirit is a promise from the Father to us. And lastly, number five, after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, the apostles were restrained from ministry until they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. Don't go out, don't do anything until you tarry in Jerusalem and you are clothed, endued with power from on high, Luke 24:49. You must have the Holy Spirit, and only then can you go out and minister. Those are the biblical reasons of why we need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Now I want to share with you some practical reasons why we need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. These are all biblically based, but they're very practical reasons, and I'm sharing these with you in light of the end times. Because I believe that if there's any era, dispensation, season in which believers need to be endued with power, baptized in the Holy Spirit, it is in our day. Number one, the Holy Spirit will cause us to be alert to what's happening and to what's going to happen. John 16, 13, Jesus said, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. Things to come. You and I should pray this regularly. Holy Spirit, you know what's to come. Reveal, show me. Jesus, you said the Holy Spirit would show me things to come. Show them to me. Now, I'm going to tell you something, folks. The reason that I'm saying I want to share these reasons with you in light of the end times, because we're living in some times that are different than ever before. They're dangerous. They're unstable. They're full of tension. We've got things happening in our culture and in our world that are on the precipice of popping and bursting. Now, I'm going to touch on this for a minute, but I want you to understand that what took place weeks ago here in Baltimore, in the inner city, with the riots that broke out and the protests and so on and so forth. You know, I've been working with city officials for quite a while now, and there has been an understanding that underneath of everything that was happening in the city was this potential for popping and bursting, okay? And I just want to say to you that cities all over America, they are volcanoes getting ready to erupt. Now, what happens if eruptions take place? Well, let's just go by what's happened here recently, okay? Regardless of your views on things, I'm not here to talk about that. What I'm here to do is to analyze the facts and the process. And what has happened here in Baltimore is when the volcano erupted and things spilled over, then what you have is you have the police department who are now backing off. Because they don't want to get slammed. So they're trying to be extra careful and cautious so their hands are off. Now, what's happened as a result of that? Well, the society understands that the police now has backed off, and so you've had record numbers of assaults and murders taking place. Lawlessness abounds. Lawlessness abounds. Things begin to unravel. And when things begin to unravel, and that happens from city to city to city to city, you then have a situation in which society becomes very unstable. So what happened here a couple weeks ago? They imposed curfews. Okay? Again, whether you agree with stuff or not, I'm just telling you the facts. Curfews are imposed, and then more control comes on the society. Right? More government control. Let me tell you something, folks. If you think, and I'm going to talk about this on a broad perspective, if you think you can rely on the government for your economic well-being, for your personal security, and for all these other things, you've got another thing coming. They are incapable once the volcano erupts. They don't have enough resources. Okay? Because what we're dealing with at the end of the day, at the end of the day, is a heart issue. And only the Holy Spirit can change the hearts of men and women. You can't legislate it. You can't go take a badge to it. You can't do anything with that. Only God can change the heart of a man and of a woman to love their neighbor. Only God can do that. That's why we need a spiritual awakening. But I'm going to say something to you, folks. You need to get ready. You need to get ready, because if there's a meltdown, and there will be, and things begin to unravel, and they will, and things begin to pop and explode, and it's going to happen, you need to be able to take care of yourself and your family. Okay? I'm not trusting the government. I'm not trusting them to protect me. I'm going to protect myself and my family. I'm not trusting the government with economic security. I'm going to tell you something, folks. The dollar is going to melt. Now, it's getting stronger around the world, but I'm telling you, there is going to come a time, okay, when the banks are going to fold. They don't have the money. It's all in computers. They don't have it. No cash. If everybody ran to the bank to get their money, it isn't there. So you can't trust. You can't trust this world. Here's the bottom line, folks. What will you do if everything vanishes? You know, we've seen pictures of that. We've had glimpses of that just in the last years, right? There are people in this congregation, probably some 10 years ago, who had their retirement, had their money in a 401k program, had their money in some stocks, whatever the case may be, had their retirement set up. And when we had a little shaking, not a major collapse, you might think it was major, it wasn't. It's just an indication of what's to come, okay? But there was a shaking. There were people in this congregation that lost their retirement, a great deal of it, 2/3 of it, 3/4 of it, and had to go back into the workforce. Does anybody know anybody that did that? Some of you? Okay. Well, let me make you aware of the fact it happened. Now, I'm just here to tell you that one of the reasons why you and I need the baptism of the Holy Spirit is because when we're sensitive and we're prayerful and we have the Holy Spirit in us, the Holy Spirit is able to make us do things or lead us to make certain decisions ahead of time. And the other people in the world be going, "What are you doing? You're crazy. You're nuts." And you go, "I'm just obeying the Holy Spirit. I know what the Holy Spirit told me, and I'm getting ready for something." You see, the Noah people who build arks when it's not raining, they're the ones that are thought of as being crazy. And so you have to prepare when things are okay. You don't prepare when the storm comes. The time to go out to Home Depot and get plywood over your house to protect you from the hurricane is not when it's bearing down on you. It's when you've gotten the forecast a week in advance that there's a hurricane that's coming and it's really going to wreak havoc, and then you need to go out and get it. And the people that go out and get it ahead of time are the ones who are going to be prepared. And I'm just saying to you, church, be prepared. Don't be stupid. Don't put your head in the sand. Listen, I'm a positive person. My family will tell you, I live on the side of the glass is half full. Okay? I'm a very positive person. But there's also a side of me that's very realist. Okay? And you and I need to be prepared for what's coming to America and what's going to come to the body of Christ. Listen, I said this years and years and years ago. I said this 15, 20 years ago, that the church needed to be in small groups. The church needed to learn how to have life, family, Christian life, koinonia, fellowship in small groups. You know why? Because I'm telling you, the day is going to come when assembly like this is going to be difficult. Why? Because the government is making it increasingly more difficult for us to do this type of public assembly. Why? Because they're levying laws concerning taxes and other things that are going to strangulate churches financially. They're going after the financials of churches because churches have enjoyed tax-exempt status. Now, here's what happens. I'm only on point one. I don't even know if I'm going to get through this. But you need to hear this. You need to understand this. Okay? Here's what happens. The government does not know how to cut spending. They don't know how to do it. Why? Because their hunger and thirst for more overrides the ability to be disciplined to cut things. So they're always going after more. So when they can't find where to get more, now recently the news has been about, let's go after the churches. Okay? They enjoy tax-exempt status, so they need to be paying taxes on this. And what they're going to do is they're going to levy that. Now, here's the problem with that. Here's what's going to happen, all right? And the Spirit of God showed me this. This is why I need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of the Lord showed me this last year. Do you remember in the book of Daniel, when at Belshazzar's feast, do you remember the writing on the wall? The finger of God came down and wrote on the wall, many, many, you fold to Carson, right? Well, before that judgment of God hit, and immediately that kingdom was destroyed and overtaken overnight, okay? What they did was, prior to that, the king went and he sent servants to get all of the utensils in the house of God. The goblets. They went after all of the goods that were used in the temple. Okay? And when they got the holy things, remember who did this? The king did it. The government did it. When the government touched the holy things of God in the house of God, judgment fell. And when I saw that last year, the Holy Spirit said to me, when the government of the United States goes to touch the holy things of God in the house of God, judgment is going to fall. Now, I'm going to tell you something, folks. The government is fooling with some things they have no business fooling with. They have no business fooling with. So here's the latest thing. I just had a meeting, a major meeting, just a few weeks ago, in which what's happening with the Supreme Court and the same-sex marriage thing that's going on before the country. Now, what that is going to lead to is imposing the fact that if I don't perform same-sex marriages, okay, then I'm being discriminatory. And as such, the church is going to lose its tax-exempt status, and I'm going to get locked up in jail, okay? Well, I got news for you. You can come visit me. You can come visit me. You can come do jail ministry because this pastor is going to stand for the Word of God above everything else. Okay? So you come visit me. Because as the saying goes, it's going to be a cold day in hell before I stand in the house of God and do that. I can tell you right now, it ain't happening. It ain't happening. But the point is, there is a cultural war against the body of Christ, against the Word of God. And when the government begins to legislate what the house of God should do, I'm telling you, judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. So the Holy Spirit will make you aware of those things to come. So what do we need to do here? What do we need to do? Here's what we need to do as the body of Christ. We have to add language to our bylaws. We have to add language to our bylaws that has it in there that this what this congregation agrees to. Okay? So we have to put the language in that marriages will only be performed according to biblical standards as we believe them to be at Life Source International Church, and that we hold to the fact that that marriage is between a man and a woman. Okay? Now, see, who would have dreamed you have to have that in your bylaws to give legal teeth in a courtroom to keep you from being sued? Who thought that? Who would have thought that? Let me give you another one. Years ago, and those of you that have been around for a little while and you were in the staff meeting, I said years ago that we need to present to this congregation an exit plan in case of an emergency here. I got into a heated discussion with a staff member over that. They thought it was ridiculous. They thought we shouldn't alarm people. They had ideas, and I said, look, we need to be prepared. I'm not saying any, you know, but here's the deal. With global terrorism happening, and now they're talking about soft targets being targeted by terrorist groups, and the call from ISIS to just wreak havoc, they've highlighted churches as one of the targets. So I want an exit plan here. I want there to be an understanding that if something happens, you need to know what to do right away so that we don't have a mess on our hands, so that we don't have everybody running to the same location. We have exits all over the place here. This section, what are you going to do? Well, half of you need to go out the back, but this half, you need to go out those doors. And there's a stairwell down there, and you need to go out the stairs and go out. This section here, those of you halfway down, need to go out that way. Those of you up there, go out that way. The way you come in, those doors. You go down, go out, all the way to the basement. So what I'm saying is these are things we'd never have to think about, never have to talk about. But you and I need the baptism of the Holy Spirit so that we have an inkling there's something maybe coming that you need to be prepared for. And it could be that our preparation will prevent something from happening. It could be that our preparation will cause us to save lives. It could be that our preparation will cause you and me to save finances if we make a decision to move something somewhere. It could be whatever. You see what I'm saying? Amen? So in light of the end times, we need to know what's getting ready to happen. Let me go through these quickly, and I'm going to close because I want to pray with people to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Okay? Let me go through these quickly. Number two, the Holy Spirit will prevent us from being deceived. Matthew chapter 24, Jesus warned concerning deception three times. He talked about deception in the end times more than he did anything else, people being deceived. And he said, if it's possible, even the very elect could be deceived. Okay? So, in John 15:26, the Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of Truth. Truth. Why do we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit? So we'll know what the truth is and not be deceived. Okay? Number three, the Holy Spirit will build up our faith. Jude, verse 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Now, why is that important concerning end times? Because in Luke 18, when Jesus gives this parable of the woman who comes before the unjust judge and is just hammering him day and night, at the end of that parable, Jesus says this in verse number 8 of Luke 18, the very end of the verse. He says, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? You know what that's telling me? That Jesus is saying, when I come back, faith is going to be at a premium. Faith will be hard to find. So your faith and my faith will be under fire. Why? Well, I guarantee you that the beginnings of it are happening. Listen, when you see believers getting slaughtered overseas, that can hit your faith. If you lose everything overnight, that'll hit your faith. If your world is rocked completely, okay, that'll hit your faith. See, that's again why, and I'm going to refer back to what I said moments ago. I believe that every person here, you need to be connected with other believers in a small group. You really do. You really need to be connected with other believers in a small group, because if things happen overnight and things collapse and our society and culture goes down the tubes quickly, which it may, could happen, and we're unable to meet like this, how are you going to sustain your life as a believer? How are you going to get fed spiritually? Who's going to pray for you? You won't be able to get to Pastor Mike. You won't be able to get here on a Sunday for a sermon. You won't be able to have this great praise and worship up here. Some of you go, Pastor, you're crazy. No. It's happening in other parts of the world. Don't think it can't happen here. Okay? You need to be connected with other people in a small group so that you can pray for one another, you can care for one another, you can look out for each other, you can help sustain one another. And you all should be meeting in small groups all the time talking about these things. What if? What will we do? Where will we go? Whose house will we meet at? What is going to be the protocol? What can you bring to the table? What can you do? What do you know? Can you grow food? Who has arms that can have for protection? What are we going to do? Okay? You need to... Let me tell you something. We've had some family discussions with our family about these very things. What are we going to do? Where are we going to go? Now, see, there are some of you that are getting really depressed right now. This isn't about you having a bummer day. This is about you surviving. This is about you being able to move into another transition. You know, I want you to think about this. Let's back off of our American perspective. Let's back off for a minute of our narrow view of history and civilization. This America thing you and I are involved in right now, it's a bubble. It's a bubble. And it's a small part of human civilization. And when you look at the history of cultures, and peoples, and civilizations, they didn't live like we're living today. This is a different era, okay? And when I read the Bible and I understand the scriptures, and I look at Daniel, and I look at Matthew, and I look at Revelation, the end times is not a walk in the park. The end times is not a skip to the loo, my darling. It isn't, you know, Cheesecake Factory and Ben and Jerry's ice cream. It's rough. It's tough. It's survival mode. Now, I hope and pray that it doesn't happen for a long time. I hope and pray. But there's another part of me that yearns for it in the book of Revelation at the very end. Even so, come now, Lord Jesus. But listen, I wouldn't be a good pastor if I wasn't sharing these things with you, okay? This is the pastor coming out of me. You say, what are you? Are you a pastor? Are you an apostle? Are you a prophet? I don't know what I am. I'm just trying to be a man of God. So I don't want everybody to get bent out of shape about my title or whatever it is. I am whoever I am to you. If I'm your pastor, then call me Pastor Mike. If I'm your apostle, then call me Apostle Mike. If I'm your dumpster, call me Dumpster Mike. Okay? But Jimmy, I always want you to just call me Mike. For Pete's sake. I've known him for 40 years. I want to be, you know, there are some people you just want to be Mike to. Right? So he's one of them. Yeah. You just, whatever. So don't get hooked. You guys know that I'm not all on that. I'm just not into that. I apologize if that hurts some of you or if that offends some of you, but I think God's patting me on the back saying, good boy. Good boy, you're not all about that. Okay? I just want to serve God. That's all. I just want to serve God. I want to be a blessing to the earth, to the body of Christ. And I want to be effective. Okay? So the Holy Spirit will build up our faith. We need to pray in the Holy Spirit. It builds us up. Next, number four, the Holy Spirit knows what to do when we don't. Romans 8:26, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. You know, I could go on and on. I've got a whole lot more here, but I'm going to stop. No, I need to pray for people. I want you to come back next week. How about if I finish next week? Is that okay? Because what I'm preaching on today is the kingdom of God. The series, I told you I'd return to it. The kingdom of God. And in this series that I'm doing, the kingdom of God, every message will have a subtitle to it that will begin with the power of. Because 1 Corinthians 4:20 says, for the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. So it'll be the power of. So today is the power of the Holy Spirit, is the subtitle to the series message, The Kingdom of God. The Kingdom of God, the power of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to be preaching for weeks and months on the Kingdom of God and then the power of different things, because everything in the kingdom is filled with power. Okay? So I want to leave you with this last question, okay? This question is based upon the same question Paul asked believers in Ephesus 2,000 years ago in Acts 19, verse 2. He came to the region of Ephesus, and he asked the believers there, he said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? You know, in the very beginning of the early church, it was kind of an expectation. He didn't know if they'd received the Holy Spirit yet. But it was just, it's supposed to happen. Did you receive the Holy Spirit since you believed? So, wow. They said, wow, we never even heard about a Holy Spirit. So they prayed for him, laid hands on him. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. Today, folks, it is essential that every believer be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost. You know, there are times, folks, there are times when I'm in prayer and all I can do is pray in tongues. I can't speak any English. I just pray in the Holy Ghost, and then I stop and I'm thinking, I'm getting ready now to speak in English to pray to God, and the next thing that comes out of my mouth is tongues. And I realize that I don't know how to pray like I should, like I just shared with you in Romans 8. But the Holy Spirit is praying through me. The Holy Spirit is interceding according to the will of God, because the Holy Spirit knows the mind of God. The Holy Spirit, I'm looking through a glass darkly, Somebody said to me the other day, said, Pastor, when the Holy Spirit speaks to you, or when God speaks to you, have you ever heard him in an audible voice? I said, no, I wish I did. I just wish he'd come and talk to me. I just wish he'd tell me, do this, do that, do this. Listen, you want to, yeah, you know, I just wish it'd get, just be so clear as that, you know. But I have to go by feeling. I have to go by impartation, and I have to go by his leading, and I have to go by these inner movings of God, these inner workings of God. And I always try to position myself neutral. Say, God, all I want is the will of God. I do that. I pray that many times. All I want is the will of God. It doesn't matter to me if it's left or if it's right. I just want the will of God. Just the will of God. Teach me, Lord. Just prompt me. Show me which way to go. And you know what, folks? Let me just say this to you. Sometimes it's not really clear. Sometimes it's not really clear, but here's what I'm not going to do. I'm not going to get intimidated by the decision to where I'm just paralyzed and I do nothing. Many times I go, okay, God, I've waited, I've fasted, I've prayed, I'm not hearing anything, so I'm just going to take a leap of faith. I'm going to take a leap of faith, and I'm going to go this way. Now, if it's something that doesn't need an immediate decision, I'll wait. I'll just wait. I'll just say, I'm not moving. But there are times when I need to do something, and I go, I'm just going to step out in faith. And you know, that's okay, because God knows my heart. He knows I want his will. He knows I'm trying, and I trust him enough that if I step out in faith and it's the wrong way, he'll block me, because he loves me. He loves you. Don't ever be afraid. Don't ever be afraid. Step out in God, and if it's not God, he knows how to redirect you. He just knows how to do it. He knows, because he loves you. But today, I want you to stand with me all over this building this morning. And if you're here today, you say, Pastor, I need the Holy Spirit. I need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I've never spoken in tongues. I need to be able to pray in the Holy Ghost to build up my faith. I need to pray in the Holy Spirit, because I don't know what to do sometimes. If you're here today and you'd say that, you'd say, just pray for me. I want you to lift your hand to heaven, if you would. Just say, I need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come be the fire inside of me, Lord. Come be the flame upon my heart. Now, here's what I want to do. I want to pray for those of you who need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And here's what I want to just say to you in the beginning. I'm not going to coach you or teach you. I was thinking about this early this morning. I thought about when the apostles, the disciples, when they were in the upper room. I wonder if they had, well, I know they didn't. They didn't have people around them. Oh, now say this, say this, say this, do this, now do this. Lift up your hands. No, put them down. No, lift up, you know, spiritual calisthenics, you know, and all this. No. You just baptize in the Holy Ghost. That's how I want to see it happen. If he did it that way in the beginning, he can do it that way today. They were freshly baptized in the Holy Ghost, okay? But here's what I do know. They've been praying for 10 days. I've prayed for people to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and what you need to understand is God's going to use your mouth. He's not going to use your ears. He's not going to use your nose. He's not going to use your eyeballs. He's going to use your mouth. So when I prayed for people, and I've had them just stand here and go, you have to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. That means opening your mouth and saying, God, fill me with your Holy Spirit. You know, people need to be hungry. Blessed are they, God, Jesus said, who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. You've got to be hungry. You've got to be thirsty. And when you're hungry and thirsty, it will be evident by you crying out to God, not by you standing there going. Here's the other one. I had people come down, want to get baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they're standing here and they go. Listen, the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit, but even He has a hard time getting through that wad that's in your mouth. So spit that stuff out. Just be hungry for God. Man, the Holy Spirit is here this morning. The Holy Spirit is present today. The Holy Spirit is in this place today. Hallelujah. And I believe that it's God's will for you to be filled with the Holy Spirit. If you want me to pray for you to be filled with the Holy Spirit, come down to the front right now. Just stand across the front. We're just going to lift our voices. I'm going to ask the entire church to lift up their voices in prayer. Maybe there are those of you who are here and maybe it's been a long time. Maybe you need a refreshing. Maybe you need a refilling. Whatever the case may be, just come. Just come and we're going to worship and we're going to pray. We're going to cry out to the Lord today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes.
Come be the fire inside of me. Come be the flame upon my heart. Come be the fire inside of me. Until you and I are one. Come be the fire inside.
Yeah, cry out.
Come be the flame upon.
Yes, yes. It's already happening. It's already happening.
Until you and I come.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Come be the fire inside of me.
Hey,
come be
my mind. Hallelujah. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Fill Him, Lord. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled. Yeah. Yeah, that's it, brother. Woo! That's it, sister. That's the Holy Ghost. My God, He's filling people today.
Be filled, be filled.